Thank you very much indeed. And the next item of business is topical questions. As ever, a member wishing to ask a supplementary question should press the request to speak button during the relevant question. And I call question number one, Graeme Simpson.
Thank you very much. To ask the Scottish Government what its response is to reports that the chief executive of Ferguson Marine is still entitled to a bonus despite the First Minister saying that he thought the practice should end.
Minister Richard Lockhead.
Despite every effort being made to ensure that no bonuses were paid to Ferguson Marine Port Glasgow senior management in 22-23, it proved, as members will be aware, unavoidable due to historical contracts at the yard. The CEO's contract entitles him to some bonus elements only if stringent key performance indicators are met. Scottish Government has been clear that these should not involve a bonus being paid directly for vessels 801 and 802. Contracts for new FMPG employees do not include bonus elements. Parliament will be updated with full details of a revised remuneration scheme once it's finalised.
Graeme Simpson.
Well, can I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer? What this shows is that no one pays any attention to what the First Minister wants. Yep. Now, on today, which is the sixth anniversary of the launch, the fake launch of the Glen Sannox, which should be clear that nobody at the yard should be getting a bonus. Humza Yousaf said in April that, quotes, there should be no bonuses paid, but there were. Audit Scotland said, quotes, while Scottish Government approval was sought, FMPG did not have explicit approval prior to payment. So who sanctioned the latest bonuses, and why is David Tymon in line for any more?
Minister.
As the member will be aware, the bonus that was in the accounts related to 22-23, and as the First Minister said, because of the cost overruns and delays, any bonuses would be unacceptable and shouldn't be paid, and that's currently what the Scottish Government are working on. Now there's an arrangement where the Ferguson Marine Board have to consult the Scottish Government, and these discussions are ongoing over the future remuneration packages. As I said before, the Cabinet Secretary will bring final details of that package to Parliament in due course. But the Scottish Government has made its views clear. There should be no bonus elements in relation to the two vessels. That's the outcome we expect, and I think that's in line with public expectations.
Graeme Simpson.
Well, I'm not sure we found out anything from that. You could possibly argue at a stretch that Mr. Tydeman should get some credit if he turns the yard into a viable business. But we've learned this week that they've stopped work on a project for the Royal Navy because the Scottish Government, Neil Gray, refused his request for £25 million of investment for a new plating line, burning tables and better computer software. So how much extra is the Government prepared to invest in the yard in order to turn it round?
Minister.
Well, Deputy Presiding Officer, the Cabinet Secretary laid out in Parliament in an oral statement just last week the current position, and I think the member was present in the chamber for that statement, so he should be up to date with the current situation. But in that statement, the Cabinet Secretary said that these discussions with the yard were ongoing and discussing their business proposition. But of course, any proposition has to be in line with subsidy control regulations and also value for money. But these discussions are ongoing. And as I said before, again, Neil Gray, the Cabinet Secretary, wants to be open and transparent and will be keeping the Parliament up to date as soon as there's any steps forward.
I've got a number of supplementaries. I'll try to get in as many as possible, but they will need to be brief as well. The responses for Stuart McMillan.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Presiding Officer, certainly, as I'm led to believe, that contracts for new employees do not include bonus elements. And whilst I do agree with Mr. Simpson that the bonuses should not have been paid, as the Minister agreed with me that the people who should be most angry here actually are the workforce on the tools who have been attempting to build these vessels for some time, taking the flak, the political flak, and being used as the political football whilst management, which has changed regularly, have received unwarranted bonuses.
Minister.
Well, from the First Minister downwards in the Scottish Government, we agree with the sentiments outlined by Stuart McMillan in terms of his support for the employees at the yard. And again, as the Cabinet Secretary reiterated to the Chamber just last week, there should be no doubt that the Government does remain committed to shipbuilding on the Clyde and to the dedicated men and women at Ferguson Marine who we know are doing their utmost to deliver these vessels. So we do continue to stand behind the workforce and we're working with Ferguson Marine's management and board to try and secure a prosperous future for the business.
Katie Clark.
Have been paid without Scottish Government approval. At Scottish Water, it is reported that three executives have received nearly £1 million in bonuses in the last 5 years. Will any review extend to executive bonuses at all publicly owned bodies?
Minister.
We expect all such payments to be in line with Scottish Government pay policy and terms and conditions that significantly deviate from that, of course, cause ministers a great deal of concern. So I can't comment directly on the situation at Scottish Water, and I'm happy for the relevant minister to follow up and a note to the member about that.
Willie Rennie.
What this reveals is that the government's completely impotent when it comes to dealing with bonuses at this company, but also at Scottish Water. Just today, the unions have said that the workers deserve certainty. But the only thing that seems certain is that the bosses at this company are going to get the bonuses, which they don't deserve. So why is the government incapable of providing any leadership for the future of this yard?
Minister.
Well, as Willie Rennie quite rightly points out, this is an extremely tough time for workforces, be they in Scottish Water or at Ferguson Marine, or indeed anywhere in the public or private sectors. And we would urge all management to take into account, and first and foremost, the needs of their workforces. We do pay close attention, of course we do, to the pay and conditions and bonus regimes of these sectors. At the same time, we have to have regard for contractual obligations and also market conditions at the same time to attract staff into our public bodies. But we will pay close attention to all these issues.
And briefly, Jamie Green.
Thank you. Obscene amounts of money over the years have been paid to well-paid executives, directors and management consultancy firms. Yet what the workers in the yard want to know is what the future of the yard might look like. Is the minister or anyone in the Scottish Government aware of any other future contracts that the yard has secured beyond Hulls 801 and 802? And if so, what do those contracts look like?
Minister.
Well, firstly, Deputy Presiding Officer, I'm not going to take any lectures from Conservative members, given that the UK Government lifted the cap on bankers' bonuses when it comes to awarding undue financial reward to certain people in our society. But the member did mention Ferguson Marine, and I just want to assure him that the Scottish Government is working with the yard to examine options to deliver its initial investment proposals so that it's compliant with subsidy control rules and aligned with current potential future commercial opportunities for the yard. These discussions, these intense discussions, are ongoing between the Scottish Government and Ferguson Marine.
Question 2, Carol Mochen.
To ask the Scottish Government what its response is to reports that stagnating workforce numbers, amongst other factors, are contributing to increased pressure on midwifery services.
Minister Jenny Minto.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. We hugely value our midwifery workforce and the high-quality care they offer across Scotland. Balancing our declining birth rate in Scotland with increased training and recruitment means we now have a significantly increasing qualified midwife-to-birth ratio. We're constantly looking at ways to enhance staffing levels and support workforce wellbeing for all parts of our NHS, including midwifery, and our nursing and midwifery task force is a key part of that. The task force will recommend action supporting longer-term workforce sustainability, improving workplace culture, practice flexibility, recruitment and retention, and diversification of training pathways.
Callum O'Connor.
Thank you. Can I thank the Minister for that answer? An article in the Scotland on Sunday newspaper highlighted key extracts from the RCN Scotland State of Maternity Report released recently, and I quote, "We do not see these ever larger surges in midwives coming out of the universities making a difference to overall numbers." And again, I quote, "The big risk is that rather than sustainability, being sustainable and building a strong workforce, the effect of these new midwives just seems to fizzle out as staff leave." Why does the Minister think workforce numbers in midwifery continue to stagnate? And when will the profession see a truly comprehensive and really importantly measurable plan from the Government that highlights how these challenges will be overcome?
Minister.
I thank Carol Mochen for her question. In June 2023, June this year, we had 2,509 whole-time equivalent qualified midwives. That's 8.3 qualified nurses and midwives per 1,000 of the population, compared to 6.3 in England. This means that nursing and midwifery levels are 32% higher per head of population in Scotland than England. However, we do recognise that we need to work harder with regards to this, and the nursing and midwifery workforce plan will be out in 2024.
Callum Mochan.
Thank you. I have met with midwives from my own region and across the country, and the stories are consistent. They do love the job and they're very passionate about the services, but they do know that they're overworked. In my own local health board, midwives are currently handling caseloads almost 30% bigger than was set out in the Best Start. The reality is the Scottish Government has not delivered a successful plan to support our midwives. It has not implemented safe staffing legislation passed in the Parliament in 2018, and it has not ensured all health boards are signed up to equally safe at work. Minister, do midwives have the right to feel badly let down by this Government?
Minister.
I think what we've got to remember is that the midwives in Scotland do a fantastic job, and yes, I accept that there is pressure in the circumstances that they are working in. However, we are working very closely with midwives and the Centre for Workforce Supply to develop resources and strategy that ensure that we give them the best conditions that they can work in Scotland.
Supplementary, Emma Harper.
It is clear that ensuring we have a strong pipeline of students will play an important role in work to increase the workforce, especially as I'm thinking about the need to recruit midwives in Dumfries and Galloway. So can the Minister provide any further information about what the Scottish Government is doing to support midwifery students to train?
Minister.
We are taking a range of actions to support midwifery students. In 2020, we increased the non-means-tested, non-repayable student bursary to £10,000. This is the highest in the UK. Free tuition is provided for eligible undergraduate students in addition to help with expenses. However, I do understand the financial challenges faced by all students, which is why we have established a short-life working group to review the placement expenses guidance to consider what more can be done.
Thank you. That concludes topical questions.